Here's your host, Craig Warmbold.
Well, thank you very much, and good afternoon. Welcome to Community Comment. Our guests on Community Comment today are with the Dodge County Center for the Arts and the newest exhibit that they've got coming up. We want to welcome into the conversation Craig Kasten with the Dodge County Center for the Arts. Craig, it's good to see you.
Yep, good to see you too.
Judy Beyer, DCCA. Wonderful to see you again, Judy.
Thank you.
And we also want to welcome Deanna Springer with it's Nancy Zieman Studios.
The Nancy Zieman Sewing Studios.
Nancy Zieman Sewing Studios. Mm-hmm. Wonderful to have you back again, Deanna.
Great to be here, Craig. Thanks.
Well, thanks for coming. And we got a lot of ground to cover today.
We do. We have lots of things.
We've got a video stream going on. If you are at home and or if you're mobile, it doesn't matter where you are, and you want to, maybe you're listening to AM 1430 WBEV on the radio. Maybe you're listening on the stream, dailydodge.com. If you could find yourself a some type of device like a laptop or a phone that has video capabilities, you can go to the Daily Dodge TV tab on the new dailydodge.com, newly designed website, and you could watch today's program. We do have some of the pieces of the art exhibit that is going. We're going to get all the details on the exhibit in just a minute, but you'll be able to get a sneak peek firsthand of some of these very things that we are talking about. Plus, you could see me put on a pair of white gloves. So,
yes.
And who would not want to see that? It's very exciting.
I got a quarter. I'll pay for it.
Deanna and Judy already have their white gloves on. So we are going to get into some quilt touching action here very soon on Community Comment, Daily Dodge TV once again. Craig, just to set the stage for us, in addition to this wonderful new exhibit that we're going to be talking about, we want to talk a little bit today about some of the hours that are changing over at the Dodge County Center for the Arts. We're going to talk a little bit about Community Art Night and a bunch of other stuff.
Yeah, we would start out with, first of all, before we get started, I want to say great job in the candidates forum.
Oh, thank you. You're too polite. I didn't run for anything. You know that, right?
No, but it's nice to know somebody that actually knows something about what's happening. And it was very good. For those people who have never been to one, it was great to hear some of these candidates in person. I knew mostly everybody personally, but I've never known them as a political figure. So it was good to hear what they had to say. It was very good. So
and
we had a great
chance
time
to talk through the issues. And you go to dailydodge.com under Daily Dodge TV as well, and you can find the not only the complete Chamber of Commerce debate, but you could also, under the audio tab, hear our one-on-one interviews with the candidates and all the races of the Dodge County Board and Beaver Dam School Board.
Yeah, it was great. So we'll talk about some of the things that are coming up at the Arts Center. First of all, we want to talk a little bit about some of the things that are happening that aren't specific show related. We just had our doors replaced, the front and back, with from Hometown Glass. They look more like the community theater's doors, which are wide open. Gives us that less Banksy look or Banky look, whatever.
It looks Banksy was cool,
yeah,
too.
It looks less like, yeah, he's a cool guy. it's less. It looks less like a bank than it does each time we do some updates to it. So it's great. If you haven't come by, stop by and
Check us out. I drove by the other day, and you're over there at Front and Maple. You're over at Center and Maple, mm-hmm. I should say. Yeah. And I noticed something was different. I thought, oh, maybe they put the lights on and they're leaving them on now. But that was not the case. It's the new windows.
Yep,
it really opens the place up.
With the new doors being all glass, you can see inside with just that one strip of lights. We had the signs changed in the windows, so they're see-through. They used to be opaque to the what's inside, and you can actually see in when you go by. It's a wonderful opportunity to do that.
It just has a new open feeling, yep. Big,
so inviting.
Broad opening, yep. Inviting. Yeah, yeah.
And sunshine yeah. Coming in makes a huge difference. Yeah, it's great. We want to talk a little bit about Kayla, who's our gallery manager. We liked her so much, loved everything she's been doing so far. And a lot of these things that we're doing now have to do with her. They don't have to do specifically more with us, but with her as making changes. She's unable to make it today, but we've made a lot of changes with her. She's got some plans coming up for the future, some things we want to do, more improvements. She's actually added plants to the building, so we look, again, more or less like a bank, and more of that, so it's good for her, and we'll do that. We're going to extend our hours. We'll be extending them during the Nancy Zieman Show, but we're going to try to expand them more with her on board as a paid employee. We want her to be there more, so we'll expand our hours more that way, and then we're going to have volunteers run the place on Sundays, so we'll try to be open at least 4 days a week, and if not, more as we grow and as we come up with better ideas.
And I assume you're always looking for new volunteers.
Anytime we can. Any volunteers, you don't have to give up your life to come help us. Just come help us for a little bit. Some of our volunteers said they would only come on Sundays once a month. We're like, hey, perfect, you're in. So you win. You get the prize. And they're coming in, and we've been working with the people to do that. And we've got, like I said, lots of things coming up.
Excellent. Very good. So you always need volunteers. You always need books, too.
Yep.
I assume that's
books,
always one of those things that, yeah. That you've got going on. We'll talk a little bit about community art nights in just a little bit. But first, we want to get into the meat of the yes. conversation today, and that is the new exhibit. In the last couple of years, how many new exhibits have you had, Craig?
Since we've reopened, probably five, maybe.
Okay,
six?
That's a good track record.
We started out. The nice thing about the art center is because it's a small group of people. Although we'd love more people to help us, is that it moves fast. So we have these ideas, we try them out. They don't really quite work the way we wanted, so we adjust and we keep moving. So we're not stuck in the same pattern of what we used to do or what we want to do, what we want to do now, and it doesn't work. And we just keep trying the same thing over and over and over. So we wanted to become a gallery to sell art, but then Kayla came up with this great. Thing where she had her photography friends. I keep saying photography. That's a tough word to say, by the way. Photography friends come out from a Facebook group that she was in, and they literally filled the place with photography, wildlife photography, and it was great. So we said, well, okay, we won't do the thing. And now, because we've got this coming up, we've got the Peony Festival coming up, we've got all of these things that we've just made adjustments. So we just keep adjusting to make it work.
Excellent. Well, that's good to hear, and that's almost a little bit how quilts are made, right? You kind of just keep adjusting and,
right.
until you make
start
it work.
Your design, it may not turn out what you thought it may turn out to be, but it'll be an amazing work of art by the time you're finished.
So so just as a quilter in general, just to talk a second about the art of quilting, you go in with a plan, and you have a design, whatever it may be, but the end product may not always 100% match that design.
Right, and it's free form. Quilting can be free form, or it can be specific. You know, you could piece a quilt with all the corners and seams matching up, or you can make an art quilt. And a lot of these botanical quilts are art quilts. So I brought in a variety today to show you. And a lot of these are original designs by the quilt artist who made them. So the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show put out a quilt challenge to make a quilt that is 30 inches wide by 40 inches long, like all of these are. You won't be accepted into the challenge if you don't meet the challenge rules. The other rule was that it had to be botanical. It had to be something with floral or gardening, etc. So you can see, we'll start with the prize winner. This
Ooh, I got to put my gloves on.
Oh,
for
I should.
Right. Ninja, we need a close-up.
Is there a trick to doing the gloves? You just put them on?
We handle quilts yeah. always with white gloves.
With white.
Don't put them on your head.
Don't put them on your head. I'm feeling a little bit like OJ here. Is it? It's supposed to feel
I knew
a little better,
is
isn't
coming.
It? Wow. This. I feel like these are gloves for somebody with a very small hand.
Perhaps. Judy and I are doing fine with them.
Okay. All right. Hi, Judy. I feel like this is what Mickey Mouse goes through then every
yeah.
time, huh?
Ooh. And mimes.
Now you can do a puppet show.
And mimes. Right. Well, Marcel Marceau certainly. Did have his work cut out for him. Okay, so
this quilt is titled
My gloves
You're
are
ready,
on,
so
and I'm ready to hold
Craig's
anything up to the camera that
lift.
Needs to be.
And we're showing them horizontally, even though at the show you'll see them hanging vertically. But this is a quilt by Lori Pichetti. She's from Lakewood, Wisconsin. We get quilts from all over the country and sometimes internationally, Germany, Canada, all different places. We receive quilts for the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show. But this quilt is titled Kong, and you can see it's King Coleus. One of my favorite plants in the summer. So it's a beautiful quilt that at first glance in the flat photography, it looks like it's a one-piece art quilt, but you can see it's dimensional. So there are dimensional appliques added on top. And each piece, if you look closely, and you'll see it, you know, at the DCCA on exhibit, she has free motion quilting everywhere, different colors, just making up different colors of greens and purples and reds. You may not think purple and red goes together, but it sure comes together nicely in this quilt, and this is actually the first prize winner of the botanical quilt exhibit. Right. So we have the first prize winner, and I'll let you take that away, Craig, and we'll reveal.
I take it, okay.
You get to take it away and set it on the secure.
Like over there,
right.
That's okay.
I love that 3D.
Well,
with
can I take it away like this?
Oh, go for
in
it.
In such a way, this is how it would be displayed?
Only upside down. You have it upside down. However, the design works wonderfully. Either any way you hang it or see it.
It's beautiful.
I look forward to everyone seeing that quilt and studying the stitches. You can look, but you can't touch, right, Judy?
Yep. Right.
Mm-hmm. So that's an art quilt, and it's a dimensional art quilt. This is also an art quilt, and it's a dimensional art quilt, but it has a traditional border like you may see in some quilts. And Craig, we may have to hold this
sure,
one. This is made by Lori Sesse, and she's an award-winning art quilter. And a lot of her art quilts are pictorial, meaning there's a picture depicted in the quilt. And these are all original designs, too, Lori. She creates these. And Lori's from Menominee, Wisconsin. And you can see her fun colors. And at first look, when you start looking, Judy wants a peek at it.
I know.
At first look, you see a female figure, a very creative, artsy female figure. But then when you look closely, you can see the leaves in her hair. Her hair is made up of leaves, and the branches are coming out behind her. So it does fit the pictorial, the botanical theme of the challenge. But this is also dimensional, too. As you hold this up to the camera, Craig, you can see there are leaf buttons and little appliques and silk flowers attached. So she made the quilt, and then she added lots of embellishments. So it's a 3D quilt. There's so many details to these quilts as you look closely at them when they're on exhibit.
And it's so amazing that, excuse me for interrupting, but it's so amazing that they can start out with just pattern material from here and there and just create these beautiful pictures and designs, and they all flow so well.
As quilt artists, we tend to gather fabrics, or we have a fabric stash, and we keep gathering those fabrics that we're drawn to or that we like. And many times, all those fabrics work together when you put them together. Sometimes you need a fabric or two, so that's when you head down to the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio and pick out an additional fabric to go with your design that you had in mind. And to nail the 30-inch by 40-inch size that's required for this challenge, putting a border on is a good idea, because as you quilt the piece together, it can sometimes shrink. All those stitches will make it a smaller piece. So put your borders on extra large and then cut them down to that 30 by 40 inch size.
And then the technique, again, you said was
it's an appliqued art quilt.
Okay.
So it's an art quilt that's appliqued, and it also has three-dimensional piece elements to it. However, it does have a traditional inner border, outer border, and binding.
Ah.
So one of the other rules of the challenge is you must quilt through all layers. So Lori put a beautiful fabric on the back, too. Oh. But you have to have a quilt front, a quilt batting, and a quilt backing. If you don't have all those elements, the jury will not select you to be in the show.
So is the technique then called dimensional? Or is that just a term you're using?
It's dimensional because of the elements she has. And you'll see when we show the next quilt, it's not dimensional. So it's 3D or dimensional. You can see elements standing off from the quilt surface. The next one is not dimensional, so that will help explain it. Good question, Craig.
You're going to have to fill along the way from the microphone.
We can easily talk amongst ourselves.
Yes.
That's a beautiful art quilt, and you can recognize Lori's quilts. The more of Lori's quilts you see, her beautiful art quilts. And she's a hairstylist, cosmetologist by trade, so that comes out in her work, too. And many of the quilters for this exhibit are also gardeners. So many quilters are also gardeners, so this was a great challenge to do. And, you know, Nancy Zieman's landscape quilts are really botanical quilts as well.
And, of course, there's flower beds, and you put quilts on a bed.
Oh, terrific. Oh.
Wow.
Good thought.
Wow.
I'm full of wise insights.
Let me write that down so I get that for later.
You could use that in the advertising.
Oh, we will.
He's perking up.
We'll take that. This is a pieced quilt. Now, if you're looking at your monitor from home or your phone, this looks also like an art quilt. It is an art quilt, but is traditionally pieced. And this is called Cocktails with Monet. And it's by Lisa Bernstein, and she pieced this together. And this quilt block is called Drunkard's Path. And a Drunkard's Path block is made up of a quarter circle and then a quarter square. So if you just look between my hands here, that is one block of Drunkard's Path. When you put those all together, you can get unlimited designs. So she got creative and made this floral quilt. This, you may think, Craig, this circle is appliqued onto the quilt, but it's not. It is all pieced. These are all, looks like 2.5, 3-inch quilt blocks. that she pieced together to create this floral design.
So you're saying she didn't just cut out a leaf that might be the shape of this green and paste
and stack it up and
stack
stitch
it up other things. It's
no.
Each
it's
one,
pieced.
Even the circle, is
right.
is multiple pieces.
Right. The green is stitched together with a seam. So if you were to turn this over and look before it was quilted together, all these pieces have seam. They're seamed together like our garments are. This is a traditionally pieced quilt, but it's also an art quilt. There's no border. There's no binding. This is actually called a pillowcase turn when you do no border and no binding, and that's how you can make that happen.
And this is a stupid question because I know it's for hanging purposes, I'm sure, but what is there any kind of direction that is given as part of the competition as it relates
there
to this?
Is
this a requirement?
Right. And that's a rod pocket, and we can show the camera that too.
A rod pocket.
That's
okay.
A rod pocket, or you might think it's a sleeve, but that's how we hang the quilts. You know, you might think you hang them like on a clothesline with clothespins, but each quilt must have a sleeve. So that's part of the challenge too. And we're a little bit flexible with our challenge. You must have a quilt sleeve that is 3 to 4 inches deep. Some quilt contest, if you don't do specifically exactly the right rod pocket or sleeve on the back, you could be eliminated from the challenge. But the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show, you know, it's all inclusive. We want everybody to be able to join our challenges, and we're not going to sweat the small stuff over the rod pocket. So
you're saying you could have the greatest quilt in the world and the rod pocket could knock you out of competition?
It sure could.
Oh,
and also not labeling the quilt properly. So if you don't label your quilt properly, you could be discarded from the contest as well. Not with the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show, though. We'll take care of you and we'll make sure that your quilt is labeled. But some competitions in quilting are very specific, and if you don't do all of that, you'll miss that. And this label is on the left side. So this is called Topography of a Hosta. So you'll recognize this, and this is by Linda M. And you can see these are hosta leaves. Mm-hmm. And this is an applique quilt. Where the other one was pieced, all those pieces were stitched together with seams. You know, put right sides together, stitch a seam, and press it open. This is the art quilt again, Craig, that is appliqued. So you start with the background fabric, lay the dark green fabric down, lay the light green fabric down, and then stitch or zigzag around the outside edges. Now, there's more to it than that. But
it's the opposite of what you were explaining before, where even though it was a circle, it wasn't just a circle that was cut out of fabric. It was multiple different circles. Mm-hmm. This would be the opposite of that.
Right. Opposite. Indeed. This is an applique quilt where you start with a background and layer. And you use different fusibles and paperback fusible webs to make sure everything is adhered down. And then you do the quilting at the very end.
Wow.
So
right.
Giant hosta leaves. Up close, this quilt looks different than further away. So when you take a look at it at the DCCA, look at the quilts up close and then step back. And they become different quilts.
Did this quilt place in the competition?
I'd have to look back.
Okay, all right.
You'll find out.
Yes.
When you visit the DCCA.
Go to the DCCA, and we should mention that this exhibit is going to be opening.
We're installing it soon,
okay.
The end of April. And Judy, I probably you probably have the hours in front of you, but we'll open it.
May 6th it is.
May 6th. And it'll be open through May and June, mostly through June, most of the way through June. But it'll be open in May for the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio grand opening, the weekend after Mother's Day. It'll be open then, so you can come see it then. It'll be open for the Arts and Peony Festival the first weekend in June. And Judy has specific hours and days and things that the exhibit will be open.
Yeah, it opens May 6th to June 19th. And like you say, the 12th, 13th, and 14th is your quilting.
Our quilt create weekend and grand opening of the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio.
It's going to be fun.
It's going to be really fun. So mark your calendar to see this exhibit, because once it's over, you know, we'll take the quilts down and send them back to the quilt makers. So now's your time to see it this May and June.
Yeah.
And the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio, you've already had your kind of soft opening. Your doors are open right now. Yep. It's your grand opening that's coming up. How has everything been going in this interim as you build toward your grand opening?
It's been really exciting. The big push was to time it when the Nancy Zieman Mosaic mural, the community mural that was painted last June at Arts and Peony Festival. It was installed on the wall of the Beaver Dam Area Community Theater, And we wanted to time that opening. So it was a push. I mean, the paint was still wet in October when we did that. So we did a ribbon cutting for the mural, and we were open. And you, if you haven't been there to the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio since October, you have to come in and see.
It's
we
amazing.
Doubled our inventory. We have more samples, more everything, more thread, more zippers. Every day things are coming in. And, you know, sourcing products has been an issue. Building materials have been an issue. But we're so blessed to have the studio come together so quickly in 3 months after Richard and Ted Zieman bought it. And we're open and we're having fun. You know, we're teaching sewing. We have a sewing classroom where you can sit down and sew on our machines. You don't have to bring anything. Just bring your some fun time and set some time aside to sew with us.
You know, not unlike the Dodge County Center for the Arts building, the former bank, you had mentioned Hometown Glass, put those new doors in, and you've got the glass, you've got the way in. Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio has been doing so much in the downtown, just even from an aesthetic standpoint.
We're deeply involved in Beaver Dam and the downtown, and we're committed to making this a great place to stay and live and work and play. So we're involved with the chamber in the downtown community events and the festivals. You know, we like to celebrate sewing, so the festivals in downtown Beaver Dam are really fun. I serve on those committees and help plan those things. And great bunch of people in Beaver Dam for sure.
Excellent. Again, that that exhibit, is there going to be a formal exhibit opening, like with the cake served and all
I
that
think
kind
so,
of
yeah.
stuff?
I think so, yeah. We'll get Kayla to rearrange that, and we'll be pushing that out, so watch our website, our Facebook page. One question I have for you is, how's the museum coming?
The museum, well, I've been working on it over the weekend. My husband and Stitch It Mr. Dennis has been helping me. We've been upstairs at the second floor of the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio curating that exhibit, putting it together. And it's a large space on the second floor of the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio where we will soft open on Friday during our Stitch It Sisters event. Friday and Saturday, I brought that along. That's on our website, too, at shopnzp.com. But we have a free event this Friday and Saturday where you can meet the Stitch It Sisters, my sisters and I. And you can also, you know, we're near the Dodge County Center for the Arts. So you can stop by and see what's going on there and stop over and see us for the soft opening of the Nancy Zieman History Exhibit. And again, we'll keep adding to that. And there's some wonderful things on the way that will be grand during our grand opening the weekend after Mother's Day.
Even grander than a grand opening. We were, heard it right here.
Yeah, we were honored to have, before COVID hit, we were honored to have the Nancy Zieman like history. And it was just awe-inspiring. And, you know, having known Nancy since our kids went to school together, I was just in awe of everything that there was. And we took the tour. We took the secret tour of the museum, and we took the secret tour, and to see some of those things were up there. And I was like, oh, I can't wait for other people to see this. This is just amazing.
And it was covered by sheets when you were there, Craig, for our business after hours.
Peeked.
Did you peek under the sheets? Well, the sheets.
That's a secret.
Sheets are off. The bed sheets are off, and we have Nancy's garments. We have three of Nancy's original quilts on loan from her family.
Wow.
We're setting up her home sewing studio with the area she had at her home where she made over 70 quilts in the last 20 years of her life. Just, you know, art landscape quilts plus everything else she did. But plus memorabilia from the beginning when she started Nancy's Notions from her kitchen table in Virginia, Minnesota, and how it grew. So we're telling the story of Nancy's life and legacy and how much she really affected people, taught them how to sew, and so much more. So. Mm-hmm. And we have a big, large output, 20-foot, I guess you could call it a banner of the Sewing with Nancy set. So it's quite spectacular. So.
Wow. Again, all of that is going to be part of the new show at the Dodge County Center for the Arts. And our guests are with the DCCA, Craig Kasten, Judy Beyer, Deanna Springer with Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio. We'll be back here in just a few minutes.
WBEV, Beaver Dam, a Good Karma brand station. Now back to Community Comment.
And our guests are with the Dodge County Center for the Arts, Judy Beyer, Craig Kasten, and with the Nancy Zieman Sewing Studios, we've got Deanna Springer. And the botanical quilt exhibit is going to be featuring so many of these just amazing, well-thought-out, inspired by Nancy Zieman, in some cases, you could say. The botanical quilt exhibit is going to be opening on May 6th. That is Thursday, May 6th at the Dodge County Center for the Arts. If you're joining us on video, you could see the top prize in the Wisconsin.
The Great Wisconsin Quilt Show.
Great Wisconsin Quilt Show. Mm-hmm. You could also see me with my white gloves on. Doing jazz hands right now, and we do have again the number one quilt, which was done using
first place winner. It's an art quilt that's dimensional art quilt.
That's the word I was looking for.
Many different elements make it up, and each year for the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show, we have a different challenge. So we have another challenge right now, 2022. It actually marks 40 years of Sewing with Nancy.
Oh, wow.
So our current challenge for the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show is celebrating Nancy Zieman and Sewing with Nancy. So you can get in on the challenge. This current challenge, it'll still be a 30 by 40 inch quilt, and all the details are at quiltshow.com.
Yeah. I feel this isn't going to keep anybody warm. I feel like there's...
It could be a lap quilt.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. See, I stand corrected. Mm-hmm. This is okay the way you can watch it on video right now, the way it's spilling over the table and things are lifted up. There's I don't have to worry about anything
it's
coming
fabric.
Undone or unglued. It's fabric.
It's
everything
fabric.
Is tied down.
Right. It's fabric, and the quilt maker did a great job stitching all of this down. So, again, Lori Bichetti made this quilt, and
good
she
job,
does
Lori.
A beautiful job. And mm-hmm. every part of it, as you explore it while you're visiting the exhibit at DCCA, will wow you. They're just beautiful. The first time I told Judy, you asked how it must be difficult to judge the quilts. And I don't have to be on the jury nor the judge, but the first time I saw the photo of this quilt, we jury them by photo. I had no idea it was dimensional until you read the description. Every quilt has a story. And those stories will be hanging alongside each quilt. So you'll be able to look at the quilts, read the story, find the inspiration from the quilt maker, and, you know, it'll make you smile and maybe make you tear up once in a while, too.
We have about 40 of them, or 24?
26.
Okay.
26. Yeah. Again, that will be at the next exhibit opening May 6th. Mm-hmm. Now, currently, I want to talk about some of the things that are going on there right now. And, you know,
nothing's happening right now. We're cleaning and painting and remodeling this. All of this stuff kicks off with the Nancy Zieman.
I guess I should say shortly. Perhaps, what I think I've been in Wisconsin now for about 16 years, and when we moved here with our then third grader, who's now out of college, her first teacher was Robin Peters.
Yes.
And Robin unfortunately just passed away a few months ago.
Yep.
And you've got something that is going to be honoring her in her passion.
Yep. Judy said she had talked to Robin about having her dolls. She creates her own dolls, and we'll have those on exhibit. We don't have any to show, but when we come back next time in May, we'll bring some with us. Judy had told me that she wasn't feeling well and didn't have the opportunity to do it. Well, then she became really, really ill, and she finally passed away. Her husband, Ken Peters, had contacted us and said, well, she's got all these dolls. We should display those. So we thought, well, it doesn't tie in with quilting, but it ties in with another great homemade something that people have made on their own. And to do that, so we're going to have our quilt expo, all the quilts there for that, and we're going to also have some of her dolls.
That's excellent.
Yep. They're all handmade porcelain dolls, you know, shaping the faces and the hands and so forth. And she puts them in a kiln, fires them, and she donated that kiln to the art center.
Oh.
It's a smaller one. We have a bigger one there too, but this is a smaller one specifically for something like this and smaller items. But her dolls are just fantastic when you see them.
And you do have some in the flyer here, Judy, and I don't know how close Ninja is able to get in on one of these half-sheet flyers that we've got here. But I do have my white gloves on, so the flyer will be okay. That is absolutely remarkable. Yes. And it's porcelain.
Porcelain. Mm-hmm.
So do we have, is there a skill set in the Dodge County area when it comes to being able to now carry on Robin's kind of vision and what she did? Or do we have people that are going to be able to use that?
If we get the kiln going, this is our goal, and to find someone to teach it. Okay. There are some ladies in the area that are, I don't know if they're still working in it, but they had been, and I'm sure they've trained some, and that's something we'll have to look into. Some of the people that did this type of painting can now step up and teach it. And so that's what we're hoping to express here and get going.
Well, that is remarkable. And so Robin did everything from the porcelain portion to the designing and the placement of
putting the clothing on them and giving a character to them, a special personality by how she dressed them, how she painted the faces. Just fantastic. Wow. She really had a gift.
And now, does this have like a separate opening? From the
no, I don't think so. Opening? I think we're going to just do it as part of that.
Okay,
but we'll see. Again, all these details are still being ironed out. We still got a week.
Okay, it's plenty of time.
Yeah, why yeah. rush it, right? We'll be posting all that. Posting on our Facebook or on our website.
And Ken is also bringing special props for them that she had.
Oh, wonderful!
Put together for these dolls. Yeah.
And certainly our condolences to Ken and the Peters family for that that tragedy. But it's good to see somebody's life celebrated as well, and all the wonderful things that they've done from an artistic sense, because that could inspire others and memories could live on with that.
We hope so.
And so much of what we're talking about today is being tied into the Peony Festival,
right?
Which is right around the corner. What's the date? That's the first weekend in June, if I'm not mistaken.
June 4th, I believe.
Okay. All right.
We've expanded those activities too beyond just that Saturday.
Yes.
So I'm on that committee as well, but it's really fun and really shaping up between the Ovens Peony Farm with all the plants that Michelle has there and everything that we have going on in town and downtown too. Mm-hmm. It's going to be really fun and exciting, and we're going to be painting tiles again for two additional murals for the BDACT Theater.
That's great. That's great. Do we? I feel like I knew at one time who the other murals were going to be, but
Fred
McMurray, of course,
and Eric.
Oh yeah, Eric Holkhurst, who taught Jimmy Stewart how to act. You know, just one of those things, and he was a star of stage, and he was in several films as well. I think he was biggest during the silent film era, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. No, one of the other things that is going on is going to be the Dodge County Historical Society and some of the things that they've got going on that Friday of the Arts and Peony Festival, including a play by an award-winning playwright. And, you know, Ninja is going to be spending the night with a few of us at the Dodge County Historical Society. We're going to do an overnight, Craig.
Ooh, there you go.
Judy, Deanna, in the haunted Dodge County Historical Society.
With the spooks.
With the spooks and all the spectral kind of imaging devices and everything. So stay tuned more on that. We don't know the date for that either. Maybe we'll tie it into the doll thing.
Will you be live on the web with that, Ninja? Okay. See what you capture. There are many stories about ghosts and historical.
When I used to give tours for the third graders for the architectural walk, they always ended at the thing, at the museum. And before we'd stop at the chamber, take a tour, and then I'd say, okay, now you guys, you're done. I'm done with you. You guys can walk over the thing, and you'd be okay. And I said, but before you go, remember, ask Kurt about the ghost of Hattie Doolittle. After a while, he came back to me and he goes, we should stop doing that. I was like, no, this is more fun. It got them interested, right? Their eyes lit up. They're like, there's a ghost? We're going to go over there. I'm like, I have no other idea if there's a ghost or not.
Many, many, many sightings and stories. Yes. Or at least many stories.
Stories.
You know, one or the other. We'll see. Ninja will have his electroplasmic cameras and everything. EMF detector.
All right.
Yes.
right.
Yeah, ESP, ESPN. We're gonna have all of it going on.
Take your quilt so you stay warm.
do a little seance. We'll be good.
I would take a quilt, but I don't want to have to wear white gloves all night. But
you could for fun. Me. It's fun.
That, yeah. It does seem like a
need bigger ones.
Right.
Sunite. Remember that? So you went to Sunite.
Yeah. That, right. Yeah. I think it was. Yeah. There you go. Right, yeah, I wouldn't want to get slime on them from the ghosts. So another thing that we wanted to talk about before we let you guys go here, we got the good folks from PAVE waiting in the wings, and they'll be joining us here in just a little bit. It's something that I think is just so important. One of the most important things that I had encountered over the years, but going back to when you're the Beaver Dam Area Arts Association, and that's your community art nights, giving the community an opportunity to chime in, to participate, and to learn a little something.
Yeah, we have. Originally, it was intended. Again, as we change directions as we go to adjust to what people want. We originally had it like an open art night. You could come and talk about it, have fun, and we'd have some art things to do, some projects to do, and then suddenly people were like, well, we want something specific to do. So okay, we painted the Halloween ghost for downtown. Then for Christmas we painted. We painted boards that would look like Halloween things, and we did Christmas ones, and then people were just like, and then we did other boards, and then they were like, we need something. So Kayla came up with an idea, and she talked to Jung Garden Center, and they said they would give us some plants, and she's going to talk about flower plants and hanging and work on that. I don't know the specifics of it because all my plants usually turn brown, so I don't know. But
you should grow brown plants.
Yeah. Cactuses? Can you kill cactuses? So she said, but she's going to be doing plant hangers and flower pot decorating, and we've got a ton of pots there. We've got a bunch of plants. We've got stuff to make hangers with, so she's ready to go. So this every Thursday from 4 to 7 in April, you can meet Kayla at the Art Center, and she can tell you all about how to make it and actually do it. There's no cost. We get asked that quite often, what's the cost? If there's a cost, we'll publish it up front, but at this point, everything is free because we want you to come in, enjoy the pots, and things are donated by Jung Garden Center, so that gives us an opportunity to give art to people without having to pay for it.
And that's just April.
Yep.
And we're doing something different every
day? Yeah, she's got a few things listed up here. In May, she's going to be doing collagraph printmaking,
garbage printmaking, which kind of attracted printmaking. My eyes.
Because using recycled materials. Right. And if you've ever seen Lara Crutchin had our show at our place this year. Found art, basically, mm-hmm. Yep. So this is to actually make prints with found art.
Oh.
So that'll be interesting to do that. And then in June, we're having a tie-dye activity. I'm not sure what it is, but I know I purchased, there was a big sale on tie-dyed T-shirts where you would take make ice cubes, and then you would wrap them, and then you'd sprinkle powder on them. And as the ice cubes melted, it created its own form. So you didn't have to, you know, and do that. So I think that's what she's doing. Don't hold me to that, but I saw them stacked up the other day, so I'm like, yep, we're going to be probably doing that, which would be great.
Is there much intersection between the world of tie-dyes and the world of quilting, Deanna?
They do. They cross over.
Is that right?
Right?
Is that right?
Anything you can do with, you know, a lot of these fabrics can be hand-dyed. You can buy fabrics off the shelf, or you can hand-dye your own, mm-hmm. or fabric paint them, and definitely you do see some of that tie-dyeing influence in, you know, you can make your own fabric and then make it into a quilt.
Really, nothing's off limits, is it?
Nothing's
when it comes right down to it,
right? Mm-hmm. Especially with three-dimensional, if you can attach it to your quilt, it can be part of your quilt.
And dyeing is quite an art, because mm-hmm. my mother was a rug mm-hmm. hooker, and she dyed her own wool, and it was like, mm-hmm. wow, that's a lot of work.
Every one of Nancy's landscape quilts began with a hand-dyed fabric. So that way background fabric in the way back is a hand-dyed by a local artisan.
Wow.
What? Oh, so like you could have just bought blue fabric.
You could have.
But
you
they bought a white or an off-white, Nancy, and they dyed it the color that they wanted it to.
Right. Nancy would choose lots of greens or blues or different things like that, but it's not a solid green. These are solid fabrics here.
Sure.
And she wanted a more modeled, you know, realistic background that looked like, it, you know, mm-hmm. hand-dye looks more like nature, like a sunset. Think of a sunset.
Right.
And it's not just one color. It's many gradating colors.
Yeah.
Huh, fascinating.
Yeah.
And certainly when you're able to use something as maybe you get the building blocks down and say something like a community art night, and then you learn multiple things and you start to add together. Yeah. I mean, that's that's where interesting art comes from.
Yeah.
It's great to try those little techniques, and these art nights are great to try all different kinds of things and techniques.
Are you thinking about doing anything similar at Nancy Zieman's sewing studio? Are you going to have any kind of public opportunities out there?
We do. We'll have a free vendor mall during our Silk Quilt Crate weekend and grand opening. We're actually taking over the Watermark Community Center as well, and we'll have sewing machine classes and make it take it. You can sit down and sew on a machine and then take a project home with you. So we have lots of opportunities and demos and innovations to share.
And Craig, remind us of the hours once again. You got extended hours.
We're going to be opening up once we start the show. We'll have extra hours for the Nancy Zieman Quilt, but for our base hours, we're going to expand them Thursdays from 4 to 7 and Fridays from 4 to 7, Saturdays from 10 to 3, and then Sundays from 12 to 3.
Excellent. Very
so
good.
So we'll be expanding that. The other thing I wanted to add, during the Peony Festival, we'll also have our bed turning, which if you haven't experienced that, that's quite the experience. They make a bed, which is just a big piece of plywood with a couple of crates underneath it, but that's a pretend. And then they lay quilts on top, and as they, like Deanna was doing, talking about the quilt as she tipped it up, that's what they do. They pull each layer back and talk about the quilt, who made it, why they made it, if it's a style, if it has a special meaning to the family, or if it's just because it looks cool, you know, that those things. Those are all the things that they do, and we'll be having that again at 11 and 2 on June 4th.
And that's from our friends at Millhouse Quilts.
Yep.
And those are bed-size quilts. These are wall quilts. So you wanted to cover up with these, Craig.
Okay. Yeah.
Technically,
all right.
This is a lap quilt size, kind of, but those bed quilts are what they will be turning.
They're beautiful, and they're amazing. It's the Escher-looking one that... He tipped it up. It didn't look like it was actually moving. It was amazing.
So what is all, you know, give us your insight, if you would, Deanna, at what all this is meaning and where we're at. Just generally when we speak about downtown Beaver Dam and kind of the changes that we've seen there in conjunction with city dollars, tax dollars, private dollars coming in and all these ideas for art. You just mentioned Millhouse Quilts. Mm-hmm. You've got your own Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio. This is essentially right behind where you've got the Dodge County Center for the Arts, the community theater. Really seems like that part of the community is on an upswing.
Right, it's a groundswell, and you can feel it as you visit the area. There's many grants available, and there's grants right now, I believe, for $10,000 to open your own business in downtown Beaver Dam. It's doable, attainable. You have a dream and a vision, you can make it happen. And we're located in the Fine Arts District of downtown Beaver Dam, and that's because we're by the theater, we're by the DCCA, and we're by the murals, the Nancy Zieman murals right behind our store. It's really exciting to see all that's going on downtown with the arts and the independent businesses really support local. People are doing good things, and you can test it out during the festivals. Our Fall Fest was really well attended, and people had no idea how many different things have happened, you know, since COVID over the last 2 years and how many stores and shops are open. And the Nancy Zieman team is producing a fiber arts tour map so you can plan your adventure, and we'll have that on our website as well, and we'll start distributing that in the community and share that with the DCCA so you can plan your fiber arts tour and exhibit. Come see and stay and play in Beaver Dam.
Judy, Craig, it's got to be really exciting to be part of this upswing.
Yeah, it's so nice to have all these additional things other than just the art center. You know, since we moved down to the downtown area, you can really tell the difference. I mean, we still are looking for people to help us out in many ways. And COVID kind of knocked the breath out of us for a while, and older people kind of not being able to continue doing certain things. And we're really looking forward to younger generations coming in and saying, hey, I like what you're doing, let's help. So
yeah, it's been a great explosion. People are interested. Mm-hmm. You know, all those years ago when I worked for the chamber or was a part of it, the downtown seemed to be neglected. From when I was a kid when we used to come over the hill on Front Street there, and then all the stuff was happening downtown. Every Friday night it was lit up to almost like a ghost town. And now with all of these people showing interest in downtown again and really revitalizing it, it's just amazing to go down there and walk and see all the great stores, see all the great, especially all the art. We're talking about putting on across Maple, we're talking about putting one of those 3D dimensional looking sidewalks that when it looks like it's 3D, so we're still working out the details on that. We've got ooh, everyone has all these
news.
Yeah, we've got all these great ideas we're going to put.
Is it a 3D of an open pit? Yeah. All right. I walked on one of those. It's scary.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe get the Beatles thing out there. We can do the little Beatles walk across there. So it's great. It's just amazing to see mm-hmm. how much this is, you know, people have put in back into the downtown and turned it into what the next version of it is. It's no longer this giant retail hub. It's craft. It's independent. It's people who care about the community.
It's community. And the DBDI has just published a new newsletter. So we're distributing that through the local businesses, and we'll have it up online too at that website. And it's really telling about all things that are going on in the downtown.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. And we'll have a Downtown Beaver Dam Inc. on in a couple of weeks. I think you've got your big Earth Day celebration coming up. I know we'll get you on the calendar for that, and we'll talk about much, much more. But in the meantime, I want to thank you guys so much for joining me on the program today.
Thanks for having us.
Yep.
A reminder that you've got the Botanical Quilt Exhibit opening on May 6th at the Dodge County Center for the Arts with the Great Wisconsin Quilt Show winners and others, your people, your neighbors, your friends from this community and beyond as part of that event. And, of course, the Robin Peters Handmade Porcelain Dolls exhibit running in conjunction with that. Don't forget the new hours at the Dodge County Center for the Arts, 4 to 7 on Thursdays. That's your community art night in your open gallery, 4 to 7. Same on Friday, except you got your artist workshops in open gallery. And then that gallery also open on Saturday, 10 to 3, and noon to 3 on Sundays. We do have to take a break. I want to thank our guests, though, first for joining us with Nancy Zieman Sewing Studio, Deanna Springer, and with the Dodge County Center for the Arts, Judy Beyer and Craig Kasten. We'll take that break and be back here in just a few minutes.
community comment, I should say, is coming up. It is 1:26, and it is time for part two of community comment. Here is Craig Warmbull.
Actually, this is break time, John. We're adding on a second part of break time.
That's right. We got bingo coming up in 3 minutes. No,
right, so we'll have to keep it short.
Yeah, there you go.
Thanks for that, Andrew. And thank you for the Chuck Mangione. I always love a good Chuck Mangione intro here on community comment.
I think it sets the mood, yeah. It's good stuff.
The good stuff. Is that French horn? Ooh.
Yes.
So actually, break time is over for our listeners that are not familiar. But you can go back and listen to break time anytime you want over on dailydodge.com, which is a good place if you're listening to us on the regular old radio, AM 1430 WBEV. You know, you could always stream us in crystal clear, near high definition audio quality at dailydodge.com. While you're at it, on a day like today, you can go to the Daily Dodge TV tab on the new DailyDodge.com, and you could watch today's community comment program. If you missed our previous segment with Dodge County Center for the Arts, you can watch back at that. We had the Beaver Dam Police Department on Friday, and they put me through field sobriety testing for the second time in a week. Find out what that was all about by going back to Daily Dodge Television. It was all planned out. No, I wasn't on the side of the road. It was in a studio and in a police station, so we'll just leave it at that. Why don't we begin our next segment of community comment? And it was part of the Citizens Police Academy. I feel all right. Like maybe I do need to explain this a little bit more. Why don't we go on and start our next segment of community comment? Our guests here are with PAVE. I used to know it was called People Against Violent Environments, but since they changed the name, I totally forget what it stands for, so they'll have to explain it to me. With us here are the Child and Teen Advocate, Stacey Berg, and Ashley Wellick, the Executive Director. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
Protect, advocate, validate...
Educate.
Yep. So close. 3/4 of the way. Almost there. But a good change, though.
Yeah.
Just the same. It's been a couple of years now since you made the change. You've been in place here as executive director for a couple of years now, Ashley.
Yes.
You guys are moving into this new facility-ish, which we're going to be talking about here a little bit later on the program today. But things seem to be moving, generally speaking, in a positive direction.
Absolutely. We're moving forward, and we are trying to do everything we can to really empower the victims in our community and help the children who don't have a voice.
Excellent. Very good. That's what it's all about at the end of the day. Of course, PAVE, one of the fine Children's Radiothon, WBEV, Good Karma Brands, John Moser Children's Radiothon recipients, and really pretty much from the beginning, and we're looking forward to that partnership again here as we plan our 2022 Radiothon, the third Thursday of November. So with all that out of the way, we do want to make sure that we shine the proper spotlight on the appropriate reason why we're here today, and that is because of for a few reasons, but the month of April is a very special reason to give pause and think about some important things that are out there. Why don't you give us all the details on April?
So April is Child Abuse Prevention Month. It's a nationally recognized month where communities kind of step forward to recognize child abuse and kind of get together to put an end to it. And it's the whole month of April.
So you're the child and teen coordinator or child and teen advocate over at PAVE.
I am.
This is something that you see on an all too regular basis, I imagine.
Yes.
Do you have any statistics or anything that you'd like to share with us or any insights that you'd like to give into the situation here in our own backyard and in our community?
So generally speaking, about 1 in 7 children experienced child abuse and neglect in the last year. Nationally, neglect is the most common form of abuse. Right behind that would be like sexual abuse, things like that. 245,000 cases were reported to CPS involved sexual assault allegations. And every year, about 700,000 children are abused in the U.S.
That's just, that's awful, but it is heartwarming to know that there is a resource that is available. And maybe not everywhere, maybe not in every community, which is unfortunate, but we're lucky here in our community to have PAVE, and you guys are expanding your services, something that we could talk about in a little bit as well. But as we look over numbers like that, 700,000 victims of abuse. Again, a good opportunity to realize that we've got people like yourselves working hard to do what they can when a child is in a situation like this. Could you give us some insight into what that is? What role you do play when you find a victim here again in the Dodge County area, the greater Dodge County area, and expanding into Jefferson County, have expanded there. What is that process like? What does that look like? What do you do?
Yeah, so typically when children come into services by us, it's usually as a referral through either mom or dad or like a school teacher or counselor. When they come in, advocacy can look anything from just listening to them talk about things that they've gone through, or helping them kind of cope with things that they've gone through. We have homework support groups, things like that. Kind of working with the family advocate that we have at PAVE so that it works with the family as a whole. And kind of touching on all the issues so that when they get older, they're not kind of progressing until their older ages.
And could you explain the nuances of that, the differences between the child and teen advocate role and the role of the family advocate?
Yeah, I can explain that a little bit. And I just want to, so last time I was here is in January, we talked a little bit about human trafficking. And so also with April, it is both Child Abuse Awareness Month and Sexual Assault Awareness Month. So you see teal and blue ribbons kind of throughout, and that teal stands for the Sexual Assault Month, and then the blue is for Child Abuse Prevention. So those are kind of the two things. And then in February, we also had Teen Dating Violence Prevention Month as well. So those are the kind of those months that we focus really on trying to reach to those survivors or those victims in the community. And so we do a little bit of a different approach. And so obviously our programming, we are continuing to grow. But right now, so we have two sexual assault victim advocates, one bilingual, one Spanish speaking. And then Stacy's our child and teen advocate. And then we have one that's our family advocate. And really, and her name is Trisha. So Trisha is really working with the protective parents in this situation. And so then the teens or children are working with Stacy. And what that does, it really builds trust into Stacy that the kids can talk to her without mom being in the room, without mom knowing. But then Stacy and Trisha can talk together and try to create a plan of moving forward. How do we deal with those things, protecting themselves, protecting their parents, whether that's texting or calling somebody. They might develop a code word saying, okay, call law enforcement. We work a lot with that with kids, especially if they're witnessing domestic abuse in the home. And so if parents are obviously creating this trauma for the children, and even if the children aren't being abused, they're still witnessing that, they're hearing it, and there's some, it's a lot of trauma to deal with and try to move past. And so one unique thing about PAVE, so is we are not mandated reporters. So that's something that if the kids disclose sexual assault or child abuse, Stacy really can take that information. We can talk as a group. I'm not saying that PAVE will never report. However, it is a complete staff decision of whether to report and how to report that. So I think I've been with PAVE almost 12, 13 years now. I can count on my fingers the number of times we reported. It just doesn't happen, especially if we're working with the parents and try to come up with a plan to keep them safe. We try not to report just because we want to make, you know, as much as we can.
And explain why that could be an important thing for a victim to realize that you are a non-reporting agency by and large.
Why is that important? Is that what you're
saying? Yeah, yes. Why would that be important to the victim? Why, if you were a reporting agency, might a victim perhaps not go to a resource like yours?
Yeah, so I think we see a lot of that with teens, especially when we talk about sexual assaults. So if you're thinking a teenager in high school, they go out to a party and they've had a few beers and they were raped. And so that really helps us because we don't have to report to law enforcement, so they don't have to worry about getting an underage, but we can go through the process of do they want evidence collection, anything like that to be done. And so we're just trying to build rapport with the youth in our community so that they can trust us. But also I want, you know, law enforcement, as we partner with them on a lot of things too, and so really building that this is our process and how we deal with things, and if necessary, we will get people involved and report. But like I said, we want to make sure that kids youth especially understand that we are there for them and not for anybody else.
You don't want to give them the idea that you'll just go to somebody right away. If they're not ready to make a decision yet, that might not be the best of all worlds from their point of view.
Yeah.
What about if they need legal help, guiding themselves through a system or anything like that? Is that are you able to direct people toward resources like that?
Yeah, absolutely. And we used to have a legal advocate position, and I was doing that for about 8 years before I became executive director. However, we have now kind of enrolled that legal advocacy in each one of their programs. So Stacy understands the legal side of things for youth, and so she's helping kids then file child abuse restraining orders, going to court with them, developing, you know, if they have any evidence, whether it's photos, text messages, things like that. And so what that does is each person is trained in that legal advocacy piece. Is victims coming in aren't having to re-traumatize themselves by repeating their story to four or five different advocates. So when one person comes in, they're working with one advocate and that's their person. And we understand that not everyone's going to get along or like somebody. And so then we'll just ask, like, hey, can I change to a different advocate? And we do that. Understanding that not all of us are going to mesh together. We're not all going to be friends. But really, who can they work with and trust?
Excellent. What does neglect look like? How does that play itself out? What are some of the signs? What are some of the things that we should keep about it? You say it's the most common form of abuse in the United States. And this is just anecdotal information, I would feel that it's probably the least talked about, perhaps.
Yeah, I think because neglect sounds like a very broad term, but it's basically like a failure to meet a child's basic physical and emotional needs. So, like, when we're seeing kids that are coming in and, say, like, their basic hygiene isn't done or they're not being fed or you can tell that they're way underweight or, you know, they're suffering some pretty emotional trauma or things like that, that would be classified as neglect. Just kind of not meeting those basic needs that we all need.
What are some of the things that you do in a situation like that?
Yeah. So what I've seen is sometimes we have parents come into shelter and they just don't know what to do because they're in such a chaotic state when they come in. So they may not even realize sometimes that the kids are being neglected. So just kind of like working with mom and dad or whoever may have come in with services for them and just kind of helping them along. If it's the child who came in independently or a teen that came in independently that said that, you know, this is what's going on or you're seeing the signs for that, just kind of helping them through that and getting them the basic things. If it's hygiene, getting them hygiene products. If it's, you know, things like that or food, helping them with that.
Okay. And I imagine when a situation like this arises, the possibility that you have to work with a number of agencies, both nonprofit and perhaps in the public, that's something that I would think is probably vital. What is PAVE's relationship with some of the resources that are available in my community, and how important is that relationship in trying to find a successful resolution in some of these situations?
So we have a lot of different partnerships, and one of the big things is we have our DART team, which is a domestic abuse response team, and a sexual assault abuse response team, so that's called SARD. A lot of communities have CCR teams, so it's a community collaborative, just something that, so with ours is it's meeting with probation and parole agents, it's law enforcement, nurses, really to come together as a group and say, how can we move forward and hopefully prevent the violence from happening? But then what are we going to do with the aftermath? Like, events are going to happen, and how do we plan and how do we work together to make sure that we're doing the best for the victim in their circumstances? And so we meet quarterly with them, and we go over, and sometimes we'll do case reviews to really get a better understanding. And then also we have victims that will, when they're coming through our program, we ask them to fill out a survey or questionnaire. And so that's for us to kind of learn from them is what are their needs, because victims know their abusers best. And I think they really have that tendency to to know when something big is going to happen or we're in that abuse cycle and they're in the honeymoon phase, like they know something's coming up. And so how do we prepare and plan for that? And so working with law enforcement, we've learned a lot, especially with the pandemic coming in. So teen dating online, we saw a really big increase for sexual assaults with that, where people are meeting each other online because the parents aren't home, not watching their computer, especially when they were, you know, working remotely or doing their school remotely. So that was something. So we have learned a lot. We talk with police departments. So Detective Heather Johnson is on our board. So that's another opportunity that we have, that she sees kind of the ins and outs of shelter and understanding what domestic violence is. And then also I can call her and say, hey, we have this situation. What would happen if you would report this or not? And so we can really get that information and help guide the victim to what is it that they truly want.
Yeah. Networking, it seems collaboration seems to be at the core of making something like this successful, which I assume is what you're kind of doing as you transition into this new facility that PAVE is working hard toward. Give us an update on what's going on plans for the new shelter, where you're at and what you need. How can we help?
Yeah. And I think I just want to put another little plug in here for child abuse awareness. So we work with the Guardians of the Children, and they are a group out of, is it Jefferson County area?
Yeah. Yep.
And so they work with kids. It's a motorcycle club. And so they have patches and they have littles and they have bigger ones. And so that event will be at our new building on April 9th.
At 10 o'clock.
At 10 a.m. And so last year they came out and we put out pinwheels. And those will be in the front of our building at 111 East Burnett Street for the month of April. So those will have a small ceremony kind of thing at the Burnett building. And last year, I believe we put over 200 pinwheels. And those pinwheels represent how many child abuse cases have been filed with CPS in Dodge County alone. So that's a lot. That's 200 last year. And so I don't know what the numbers look like going this year. But it's really impactful. And they have the kids there that either survivors or they're just a part of the club because their parents are. It's very impactful. We have my family came last year, so nieces mm-hmm. and nephews were able to put a pinwheel in the ground and really explain to them in a different way that, you know, there's other kids out there that need help and guidance. So that'll be at the new event or the new building on April 9th. The new building is coming along. happy to announce at the end of March, it was end of March, I believe. We did raise the funds to start renovation. So that was a grant called the Neighborhood Investment Grant. And that was part of the COVID funds that were put out through the ARPA funding. I did apply for those, and we did receive $3.2 million from them. At this moment, we're still waiting for the grant contract from them. But I don't want to leave out how much money we've raised before that. So we raised about $1.4 million from community members in the Dodge County area. And they were really like that stepping stone for us to get where we are. They were the ones who helped us put down a down payment on the building we found, believed in our project, doing 3 to 5 year pledges, and really just supporting our mission and what we want PAVE to be. And we dreamt big, like this is our dream shelter, and I'm happy to say like it's gonna happen. We don't have final numbers yet as to with inflation costs. Obviously, this has increased a little bit at 20%, but we're not officially there yet because we got to put this out for bids. We got to get it approved through the state. So it's all going to take some time, unfortunately. But once we do get the grant contract, we have 2 years to use the funding, so it has to be done within that. Did talk to WDS, and they are our construction that we have contracted with. And so they are working right now we're finishing up our designs, conceptual designs, finishing that, and then it'll go through, try to figure out design of HVAC and plumbing and things that I have no idea about. So once they tell me what we're doing, then I'll for sure go. But yeah, so that's exciting. We also, through that other funding process, we did receive another grant for about $176,000. At that point, I wasn't sure how long we were going to be at the current shelter, and the state that it's in is in dire need of repairs. So we got the $176,000 to really renovate, fix up the old shelter, and that's going to help with resale value. But right now, we're not going to be able to get into that new shelter for 2 years, and these things can't wait. We have a leaking window. it's a disaster.
Elizabeth is pretty.
It's endless. In rough shape, but we've been there 34 years, and about 21 people can fit in the shelter anytime. So, 32 years is a long time to be in a house without a whole lot of upkeep because we are a nonprofit. So, we typically don't get funding, and grants don't want to pay for those things. They don't want to pay for the building or repairs or maintenance of it. So, that's where the community comes into play, especially with those operating expenses. So, utilities, water, things like that, is typically our grants don't pay for that. They like to pay for salaries and people doing programming, and so that's where we need the community support each and every year to help us with the operating costs. So that's exciting news. So hopefully within 2 years we will be in the new shelter.
That's got to feel so good to say, such a burden lifted, I would think, when news of that grant came along.
Absolutely, especially we launched our capital campaign 3 months before COVID hit, so that put a huge damper on a lot of things and trying to reconfigure, like, is this even possible still? How do we do it? But I'm glad that, you know, we didn't give up and we looked for different opportunities. And the other thing with the grant, it's not money coming from our community, so I really hope that this helps others see, like, we want the community to invest in other pieces of our community as well, and so we're not taking those funds out of the area, which is, I think, is great.
What is this new shelter going to afford you that your current shelter cannot meet, cannot do? What are you going to be able to do with this? For those that didn't follow this from the beginning.
Yeah, so our current shelter is 1,200 square feet. That's 1,200 square feet. The new building we're going to is 3 floors, and it's 12,000 square foot on each floor. So possibilities are endless as far as what we can do. However, on the first floor, I don't know if people are familiar with the building, where Step Fitness used to be. That is the area where offices, so staff offices, will be in place, a conference room, a boardroom that we've never had before. But the great thing is the shelter is going to be more inviting, more inclusive, and people really have that time to heal. So we did a more pod-like setting. So it'll be two families sharing a large room, but they'll have two bedrooms, a kitchenette, living room kind of area. So we'll have 8 of those kind of established. And then 3 emergency apartments up there as well. So that could be LGBTQ, it could be male, terminally ill, elder, that if they can't function very well within the community or communal living with other people, they have that opportunity to go there. And then also those emergency apartments can be used for anybody at high risk of homicide. So we work with law enforcement where they ask a series of questions to kind of help us figure out if they are at high risk of homicide. And if they are, then that's where we'll put the emergency shelter, will be used for those events. And it could be a long-term stay, it could be a couple days. It really depends on what the victims need. So those are some great things. We'll have a big gathering room in one of the old apartments up there. The apartment that's standing up there is 4,000 square feet. So it is a large space that we can use. We can have holiday events, different parties for the clients, because right now we've been utilizing different churches and places that we could go. However, with COVID, we haven't been able to do that. So really be able to do a lot of stuff in-house, work with other nonprofits as far as if they need a space, like a meeting space, or, you know, we can utilize some of our areas.
That's great. And big events like the event that you're having on the 9th. That's this Saturday. Did you know that?
Yeah,
the
9th?
Wow.
I didn't. I've audited on April 11th, so that's my focus right now.
So where do I get a pinwheel? Can I get one right now? Do you guys have some here? Do I have to get the pinwheel the day of the event? What does that look like?
So last year, they actually brought the pinwheels. The Gardens of the Children brought the pinwheels. They kind of leave them out for people to put in the ground. So if you can grab a pinwheel, if the kids want to grab a pinwheel, if an adult wants to grab a pinwheel, you can grab it and then put it in the ground. I'm sure if you wanted to bring pinwheels, you could.
They sell pinwheels elsewhere, so you don't just have to wait for these.
Yes, I heard Oriental Trading has them pretty cheap.
Yeah, pretty cheap.
Yeah.
But it's the symbol that that comes with it, and it reflects the fact that the community is kind of unified in this in this issue.
Yeah.
It starts at 10 a.m. on 10 a.m. Saturday. What other kind of things do we need to know about this? Should we bring the family out? Is this an all ages type of situation?
Yeah.
You want to bring the kids out and have them show their support?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a community-wide event, so anyone is welcome. Last year, like Ashley said, she brought her family. I brought my family. It's very kid-friendly. It's a pretty simple event, but everyone had a lot of fun last year, and it kind of was a very, like, humbling experience.
And it's not real long. I think last year we were there maybe a half hour. We do a little welcome and do a small ceremony of how many kids in Dodge County have been affected, and we go through that. So it's not a real long event, but it's just a small ceremony that we can recognize child abuse in the area and how we can help them.
Yeah. 200 kids had a situation referred to Child Protective Services, if I heard that correctly.
Yep.
Yeah. Right, just from Dodge County. There are people out there that may hear this and think, I want to get involved. I want to do something to help. Maybe I could volunteer or something like that. A, do you need volunteers? And B, would this Saturday's event be a good opportunity to maybe let you guys know that there might be somebody out there that's interested in that?
Yeah, absolutely. And you're in luck because Stacy's also our volunteer coordinator. So she'll be there and she helps with the volunteers. But yeah, definitely. We always accept volunteers, which leads me into the other good thing we have coming up, which is Sweet Thanks, is May 6th. So that is just about a month away. We usually had it in March. However, we moved it to May for some nicer weather with hopes. We will be in person this year, finally, going back to the live dessert auction.
Very nice.
So we'll have that along with online auction. We're going to do an online kind of silent auction thing, but it's always a good time. Tickets are available on our website. So it's pavedc.org, and then there is a Sweet Thanks tab on the top. So you can buy tickets online now. Everything's going to, hopefully we're moving everything online. So they'll be $25 a ticket, $350 for a table reservation. So that means reserved seating for eight with two certificates for bottles of wine and some other little goodies. So that's $350. That includes the eight tickets and the wine. And then we also have like mystery packages. And that was developed last year to really support our communities in those times. And so we were giving away local gift cards to bars, to restaurants, and really just try to support local, to serve local. And that's really what we're going to continue to try to do each year, is really help these small businesses in our area who do so much for us throughout the year.
Got your auctioneer lined up already?
I'm not sure. That's Stephanie who takes care of that, not me.
But I mean, it is such...
But usually Julius comes.
Usually Julius. That's such a fun part of the event. I've been to a couple of these Sweet Thanks now, and, you know, seeing the community get together and bid on, you know, whoever's cookies it may be, or the brownies or whatever it is, and the fun and the joy that comes out of that. And then do you do a little spread, like an hors d'oeuvre thing or something?
Yes, we will. So we'll have barbecue sandwiches from John Henry and a couple of those other items.
Okay.
So Great Harvest will, I'm sure, be donating some desserts and some sandwiches. It's a fun event. And last year we did a little drive through at the new building, but it wasn't the same as in person. So I'm excited to get back out and really. So there, if you want to come see some blueprints, pictures of the new building, we will have those out for display. And then we'll be playing a short video just about our capital campaign and where we've come from and what we're hoping to do in the future.
And so where is it again?
Sweet Thanks is going to be at the Chapel of Archangels
on
Madison Street.
And that'll be Jim and Jimmy's wine, perhaps, that will be
seeing? And probably Rock and Wool. They might be there as well.
Rock and Wool as well. Excellent. Very good. That's Sweet Thanks again on the 6th of May. Also coming up this Saturday, you've got your Guardians of the Children, the Pinwheel Festival. Show your support for all of these opportunities while we're throwing out dates and numbers. Numbers for those who may be interested in making a donation through the business line, or maybe those who may want to reach out to PAVE for other services or whatnot. What are some good numbers?
Yeah, so our crisis line number is 1-800-775-3785. And that would be the Beaver Dam office, so you will get staff that way. And you can use that as a business line or crisis. And then our texting line is 920-344-0123.
Okay, some excellent resources here in the community. April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, Sexual Assault Awareness Month. Stacy, when you reflect on the importance of this month, what do you want our listeners to keep in mind here from this conversation?
I think just to be aware of the signs and just kind of be mindful to be able to help out kiddos in the community and know your resources and reach out to us if you need help with anything and, yeah, just kind of protect.
Yeah, kids. Protect. Yeah. Validate, educate, and
educate.
Educate. Yeah. And Ashley, yeah. The same general type of question. What do you want our listeners to take away from the conversation in light of all these things we've talked about today?
I think really just listening and talking to our youth. They kind of know what's happening. And the other thing is really the technology thing. I know as us adults, sometimes we kind of lose track of that, but how dangerous online cell phone applications can be, you know, Snapchat, things like that. So really educating yourselves on some of these dangerous sites for kids to be on is one of the things that I always try to promote and focus on.
Well, I want to thank you guys very much for joining me today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Once again, that is Stacy Berg. She is the Child and Teen Advocate with PAVE. Ashley Wellick is the Executive Director, pavedc.org, for more information about any of the things that we've talked about today. That's going to do it for Community Comment.